Are you all right? In the name of the Friedrich Ebert Foundation, welcome to this seminar about the impact of the election of Trump for Latin America and Brazil. The Ebert Foundation is a political foundation that works with the Social Democratic Party in Germany, SPD, and unions and various civil society organizations in several cities across Germany and 100 countries worldwide. As you know, Germany has a very different relationship with the US in comparison with Latin America. Let me say a few words about this. Germany, West Germany, was liberated from fascism by the Allies, among them the US. And this marked the post-war era in Germany in various aspects of our culture, economy, trade, and politics. This strong relationship changed with the Vietnam War and the left-wing movement in the 60s and 70s. We also had many protests and a change in the policy vis-a-vis the United States in relation to the invasion of Iraq. Our Prime Minister, Gerhard Schröder, refused to cooperate with the invasion of Iraq, which caused so much irreparable damage to the Middle East, as we can see now in hindsight. However, relations with the US were strong, and my country now is in shock with the fact that one of the countries with the oldest democratic institutions, like the US, is now led by Mr. Trump. The perception of the US in Latin America obviously is very different and is marked by the confrontations during the Cold War era and the dictatorships, the military dictatorships in Latin America, and by the struggle of the US against the left in various countries across Latin America. It's also marked by the damage done and continues being done by the so-called war on drugs, in a way which is very destructive and inhumane, as we see in Mexico and Colombia. Obviously, also, the relationship between Latin America and the United States is marked by the business of extractive industries such as oil. The US is the biggest foreign investor and the second biggest buyer of Brazilian exports, for instance. Also in Latin America, the US are connected to Latin America with a human and cultural exchange between, through, let's say, the immigrants and their history in the United States. So why talk about Trump? I was thinking about this the other day. Can't we simply ignore this gentleman, this sexist, racist, misogynist, egocentric gentleman? Can we? Why don't we talk about something more pleasant? Unfortunately, no, we cannot. He is making the most of the fears of the population who want a less complex world, more organized along the lines of nation states, a world dominated by white males born in the past century, in fact, like the cabinet in Brazil. Here we have it already, and we cannot ignore Trump because he is going against our norms, civic norms, humane norms, and liberal norms. He uses the mass media, for example, Twitter, to disseminate lies and accuse the critical media of being false news propagators. He's also symbolizing a new type of politician, the anti-politician, the businessman that pretends that it comes from the world of work. But he's a millionaire, isn't he? A billionaire that profited a lot from global capitalism. And now he says he's against global capitalism and is with a nationalist rhetoric. Well, what do you know? We can say a lot more about Trump, but the major problem is that we have many Trumps, many other Trumps all over the world. It's a phenomenon, not just a personality. They are politicians that pretend to have simple solutions for a more and more complex world and promise the good old times for those who did not profit from global capitalism. These politicians make the most, take the opportunity of the failure of savage capitalism, globalized savage capitalism that has dominated politics. So we are experiencing dangerous times for democracy and international relations. Perhaps we are witnessing a wave of right-wing conservatism that wants the end of multilateral politics that was created in the past by, among others, President Lula da Silva, for example, of Brazil, the end of a North-South dialogue that was created, among others, by Willy Brandt in the 70s, an SPD prime minister, with a major dialogue with Africa, Asia, and Latin America, and also a South-South politics created by the BRICS leaderships in more democratic times than the current times. We are witnessing the most difficult moment since the Second World War, in my view. We have autocrats like Erdogan in Turkey, Putin in Russia, among many others of right-wing politicians in Europe, either in power or on track to take power. Many names we saw in Netherlands, etc. So as German history teaches us, and also the current situation in Brazil, we don't have any guarantees that rights that have been won over in the past will remain. We have no guarantees as to that. Democracy always has to be defended. So to keep our values, maintain the dialogue open with countries that are challenging these values, this is a very important process. But this dialogue, it's not only between governments, but must also be with other players, other actors in civil society, like unions, academics, activists, and politicians, as we do today, as we are doing today. So that's why I am very grateful for Navidanio, Ana Vidanio, Thomas Pali, Rafael Lores, who came from very far away to be with us to discuss this with us today. Thank you very much for making that long trip to be with us in São Paulo today. I wish for a fruitful good morning, everyone. And we're going to begin the first panel about the impacts of the election of Trump for Latin America and Brazil. This seminar, which is organized by the Friedrich Ebert Foundation, by the Perseu Abramo Foundation, by the National Institute of U.S. Studies, and by the Reflection Group on International Relations, GRRI. I am Yoli Iliad, a member of the board of the Perseu Abramo Foundation and very proud member of this reflection group, the GRRI. As everybody knows here and people who are watching us on the FPA TV or over the internet, it was a group that was created 5 years ago in 2012. With three main aims. The first was to have a dialogue, a coordinated dialogue of activists from different sectors, intellectuals, members of political parties, public sector managers, representatives of social movements, NGOs, members of government, from different sectors that had among them the common factor, the defense of a progressive foreign policy, a foreign policy in consonance with the left-wing project for the country. So at that time, this group of people identified this policy, this progressive policy, with the general guidelines of the foreign policy that was being put into practice by the Lula government from 2003 onwards, and that became known by an expression coined by one of its main formulators, policymakers, Celso Amorim, minister, foreign minister Celso Amorim, is a foreign policy that was called active and sovereign. So to put into contact, to have a dialogue between these different people that worked with different aspects of foreign policy, that shared this progressive view, left-wing view, about how this foreign policy should be carried out. The second aim, in connection with the first, was to fight for support among society for this foreign policy. Among society, because the opponents of this foreign policy were doing this constantly. Everybody's sick and tired of watching the mainstream media giving, amplifying opinions from right-wing think tanks and consistently attacked this foreign policy, and therefore it was necessary for the sectors that agreed with it to come to the fore and fight over social support for this policy. And the third aim, no less important, was to work towards the democratization of the Brazilian foreign policy through the creation of channels of social participation for its policy, for its making, for its formulation, and hopefully its execution as well through, let's say, councils, conferences with social participation. These were the three main aims of the group. And as I said, the group was created in 2012, and I was looking through our materials, our documents, when we set ourselves up, we were officially created. There was a whole process, of course, of reflection, but officially we were born in May. Therefore, we are very nearly having our birthday. So 5 years is a relatively short time, but I think we can all be proud of what we've done so far. Beyond our regular meetings among ourselves, which are closed meetings, we held various public events, including a major conference in conjunction with the Federal University of the ABC region here in the São Paulo metropolitan area, many seminars such as this one that we're holding right now. We published a book, and we've published various articles and opinion pieces, notes, as we call them, that reflect the opinion of the group as a whole. We think this is necessary. When we think this is necessary in relation to a given fact of Brazilian foreign policy or international relations. So we have a weblog. We have an active weblog. It's called Brasil no Mundo, Brazil in the World, and also with partners, including a publication called Carta Capital. There are more than 100 members of this group right now. It is no lie that when I say that we are asked for entrance, for entry by new members. So our work is only just beginning, and it is important to highlight that the setting we operate in today is very different from 5 years ago, of course. Domestically, there's no need to even mention it. We are under the aegis of an illegitimate government, unpopular. A government that postulates a foreign policy which we might call passive and submissive, as opposed to our previous policy. But internationally, there have also been deep changes. Catarina has already mentioned some of these. And there's more and more signals, clearer and clearer signals of the amplification of the crisis, the instability of the political and economic system globally. And one of these signs is the election of Donald Trump. So we could say that Trump's election is, on the one hand, a consequence of this instability, this crisis, this instability in the global system. But on the other hand, is also tends to be as well a cause, a vector of further instability and further crisis. And this is precisely the theme of our first panel. So let me find my crib sheet to talk about the impact of the Trump government on international relations. And so we will have the pleasure of the participation of three contributors. So I would like to invite our speakers to come up to the stage. Rafael Yoris from Denver University in the US. Thank you for coming. The second is Sebastian Velasco from the Institute of US Studies and also from the group of reflection on international relations. And the third, Marco Aurelio Garcia from Unicamp, the Campinas University, a former aide to Presidents Lula and President Dilma for international affairs. He is on his way, and he'll be here in time to make his remarks. He apologizes, he had a problem, but will be among us soon. We formulated a few guiding questions for our debate, so I think it'll be interesting to read them out. So the questions are, what is the meaning of the Trump era for international relations, for Latin America, and particularly Brazil? What are the impacts on multilateralism, the role of the UN, and other organizations geared to the defense of peace and human rights? What are possible relations from other powers, states, and international blocs? And what are the reflexes of such policies on questions such as security questions, energy, and environmental? Simple questions, easy questions, right? And because they're so easy, we're going to give our speakers 15 to 20 minutes, which will be certainly more than enough. Of course, I'm joking. These are complex issues. We are demanding our speakers to be very, very summarized in their remarks. So after the speakers, we'll open up for questions from people present here, but also over the internet. So we have here I have here a message to read out. People have to use the hashtag Seminario Trump with capital S, capital T, Seminario Trump. And our hope is to reach the trending topics ranking today. So, simple procedure. We receive questions with this hashtag or from the public, from the audience here. And then we hand the mic back to our speakers for them to comment and reply. So without further ado, Rafael Yoris, thank you very much for your presence. You have the floor now.
Good morning to you all. It's a pleasure to be here. Of course, I have to speak on the mic. I'm sorry, I am already very loud. It's a pleasure to be here. I'd like to tell you that it was a long journey to be here, but it's a pleasure to be part of this conversation. Such an active group of people, including Priscila Abramo and Friedrich Ebert Foundations, Gonzalo, people, and Yoli, Katarina, people that are directly involved with these issues. I like to make my comments on the time that was given to me and take part of this conversation. It's important to think this collectively as a network. So to start, as we all know, from the beginning of the month, Aloysio Ferreiras Nunes, I'm going to read, the representative Nunes from the SPP Paulista took office as Minister of Foreign Affairs, substituting José Serra. We were expecting a lot from the latter due to his political history, but his office was characterized by temporary mandate, illegitimate, with a very reduced legacy. In this scenario that simply continues the tradition of Brazilian diplomats, we have simultaneous translation, so we have to ask the speaker to speak more slowly. So what could we expect from international actions from Brazil in the current context defined by the so-called Trump era? From my point of view, I think we have major challenges ahead of us and possible opportunities for Brazil and Latin America. First of all, we know that Trump represents the American enraged nationalism, ever present, but most recently expanding, supported by the Tea Party, a reactionary xenophobic movement that is organized to fight against Obama policies as of 2009. Although many expected that Trump and his party could not coexist in the power, what we've seen since last November is an approximation between two parties that is characterized by selfish instruments. In the American Senate and House of Representatives, they all have been defending the current president, especially the Senate. And Elin Chao, for example, the Minister of Transport, came from the Senate. After Trump's failure last week, because it's, I'm sorry, I have to constantly update my presentation, but after last week, it's not clear how Trump's administration will define its priorities. We know that people that are close to the president are still being constantly denounced by the press because of involvement in corruption and lobby scandals. And the government as a whole is fighting the problem of the Russian influence in last year's election. In the philosophy of the more we try to deny, the more things come out, as it happened in the Watergate scandal. And after all, the American press is trying to be more investigative after the beginning of the coverage in Trump's campaign. We have seen that now the Trumps are, especially the Trump is focusing on executive orders. His policy with the, his relationship with the parliament is getting more and more complex. So on the risk of trying to hit a moving target, a government that doesn't show clear positions, I think that some issues can be already investigated. If on one hand the ultra-nationalist Steve Bannon is consolidated as one of the biggest influences in the White House, other key positions are being occupied by more pragmatic profile, such as the State Secretary Ross Tillerson, Defense Secretary James Mattis, and the new assistant, the National Security McMaster, the general. So we can imagine that, we can say that there will be some bureaucratic dispute to try to fight against nationalist attacks. It doesn't mean that the interest to try to protect the traditional zones of influence, such as Latin America, will not be a focus for the American administration and their actions on our hemisphere. So in spite of the relevance of the theme of the South Frontier and undocumented Latins in general, the main leverage of Trump's campaign last year, going beyond the issue of the so-called wall, the big wall, this relationship with the South neighbors still need more definition. We know that Peña Nieto, the Mexican secretary, is trying to prioritize this issue of the payment for the wall in Mexico. And Peña Nieto has been using the situation as a way to try to improve his own popularity in Mexico, that it's reaching an ever low record, although we know that this issue was not satisfactorily dealt with by Trump or his team. Although that In spite of the fact that Mexico will pay or not for the wall, it's very likely that Mexico or Brazil will not be the focus of Trump's administration. So Alicia Nunes and Trump relationship doesn't include an evolution, includes the evolution of this neoliberal relationship, although the global context doesn't seem very favorable for that. So different states are trying to reverse the protectionism speech from Trump, and this neoliberal vision is very much in fashion in Latin America and Brazil, but it's not likely to be successful. And on the other hand, the movement trying to suggest a great integration between Latin American countries is starting to arise in some countries, led by different ideological matrix such as Mexico and China. So we have been starting to see this, as Brazil should and will respond to this calling is still a question. Considering this PSDB policy, the necessary participation of Brazil in this history doesn't seem to be likely, given the non-ideological focus that we are trying to reach, that Itamaraty is trying to impose on us. So it's the current foreign affairs minister is up to describe how we are going to translate as the new philosophy of the department. So now, given Mr. Nunes' comment on Trump, and our position is that this is a mistaken orientation from the ministers. We are getting closer, closed among ourselves, and so even if it's not clear how United States actions will be directed to the hemisphere, if it's going to be more militaristic, interventionalist, what we know is that the low relevance of environmental issues for Trump's administration, one of the issues that was brought here, the unilateral position of the country, we know that these topics are not relevant for Trump, which tends to decrease our importance in the American strategic planning ahead. So we can glimpse beyond the immigration issues if we have regional leaderships, maybe Jorge Castaneda, the former foreign minister from Mexico, we can agree or not with the possibility of it happening. The most likely is that Latin America will hardly benefit from Trump's administration, unless we consider as positive that Trump's administration does not have an interventionist ideological position for our region. But this is not a consolation for us. So going beyond these challenges, is it possible to see a broader context and see windows of opportunity in these situations? I think we have three key areas that we can consider. First of all, the relationship with China that may be in a more complex relationship with the European Union and a relationship with Latin America. So with China, now we are still talking on economic issues where the country is playing an important role in the Brazilian, in the regional growth. And that is characterized by a primary export in the short-term planning. And we know, to make it clear, that the slowing down of the Chinese miracle, the most autarkic phenomenon in the last two or three years, threatens the sustainability of this relationship, is still, and also considering the American interaction with Asia. We don't know what we expect, but maybe a greater distance between American Brazil, and that China will then substitute the empty seat left by United States searching for more private and public funding for projects in the region, especially infrastructure projects, and a more approximation in after the gap left by the United States. With the European Union, this relationship could go deeper, but the serious crisis lived in the region also presents specific difficulties. The current Brazilian Minister of Foreign Affairs, if continues in the office, Aloysio Nunes, pointing out to a solution accelerating the negotiations between Brazil and Europe. But given the fact that we have not definitely developed this relationship in more favorable moments, it's risky to say that we'll have major changes in this area, regardless of what's happening in France and in Germany. In the upcoming elections, we'll have more a greater notion of what's going to happen today. The United Kingdom started the Brexit, and so then after that we'll have a better forecast of what's going to happen in the bloc. So Europe and Brazil point out to difficulties and this process. And a last comment on this topic: we are here invited by a Social Democrat Foundation. Brazil and Germany is now sharing the anti-corruption work group against corruption in the G20. This was before, which was created before the impeachment. It brings visibility to problems of fighting corruption. And Aloysio Nunes himself is involved in many corruption scans. So we cannot hope to have an active position from him in this fight against corruption, for obvious reasons. And still at the global level, the topics where Brazil could have a strong hand in negotiations, alternative energy sources, environmental potential, the presence in peace forces, a greater role in the migration crisis doesn't seem to be relevant topics for the U.S. So the leverage that Brazil could have in these situations becomes frail. So in this disrupted global scenario where we see a destroyed world order that was created after the Second World War, where could we find more space for us? From my point of view, in Latin America and in South America, this is not a new idea, but I like to bring this. In Latin America, Brazil could play an essential role in keeping the regional balance, especially in what referred to the long-lasting crisis in Venezuela. We have here Professor Marco Aurelio that played a key role in these negotiations. In these actions, it was understood as necessary by the United States in different occasions. Yes, we're going really fast with translation, so let's try. We have different demands, but it's our situation of trying to think of the external situation. So we like to highlight that in addition of being responsible for this regional stabilization, the United States, in a coherent and a smooth way, did not try to actively take the legitimacy of Brazil's administration and along this last administrations, at least until Obama, where we know that we did not agree about Iran, about the coup in Honduras. So I don't think that it's likely that the United States tried to actively engage with Latin America. And we don't think that they are going to try to undermine this integration. Although Trump's administration is zero-sum game in terms of foreign affairs, it's so out of their radars that I don't think that we'll see movement against us, at least in the upcoming period. Of course, all this international relationship will depend on how Mexico is going to respond to Trump's attitude against Mexico and the region. Of course, that Mexico has ability to negotiate their relationship with the United States, that it's more complex than other countries in the region, especially South American countries such as Brazil, given the fact that they have a more interaction between their economy and the United States. And we know that they are in a weakened position now for more diplomacy. So through trade agreements as they were built in the last two or three years, this could point out to a solution for the great interaction among our countries. We have seen important debate in the last two or three weeks on this subject with a project of a regional relationship. And although we did not have an unanimous positions, we don't know how Trump is going to react. What seems to be clear is that for Brazil, our scope of action that would be most recommended in this area of the Mercosur that requires attention from all of us, CELAC. And although this would require more negotiation in terms of the countries that are part of the TPP, that allows for negotiation that excludes the United States as an intermediate. So to make this regional relationship more feasible and long-lasting beyond trade relationships, we would have to have a more strategic and social interaction among these countries in a broader relationship, areas that could be, that could go beyond the trade agreements. Regional security, the fight against drugs, border control, regional migration. And although we have this repeated regional inertia for a more assertive attitude in these negotiations, the urgency of these issues will maybe allows us to have a closer relationship with other countries in the region. Of course, this is very different from what I would like to see and from what I think we are going to see. I think that this is the way we should follow, but I don't think that it's the most likely to be followed in the region. So I'm proposing here a regional approximation. This could have a great potential to be fruitful for Brazil and the region as a whole. It doesn't seem to me that with the current leaderships in the country, especially with the leadership that we have, I don't think we are up to the challenge of trying to create this relationship. In the United States show their aggressiveness and the support to this illegitimate appearance of the right wing and the growth of the right wing actions in the country. So given the global crisis of democracy, of liberal matrix, institutional democracy, competitive liberal democracy that we see in the world. So from what we see in the world, the arise of the Trump administration and other right-wing leaderships around the world, maybe we are seeing a pragmatic new order that is different from what we've seen after the Second World War, where we had more social actions, social leaderships. We see in the United States today the final struggle of a deep crisis. And this is more reason for Brazil and Latin America to be involved in the negotiation of the new orientations in global institutions that will try to lead the world in the near future. So here's the challenge, and we would like to be involved in that. What clearly, given the pro-alignment, pro-systemic orientation of the interim government doesn't seem to be able to respond to those challenges. So these are the challenges that I think we face. And if what we see today is not a deep crisis of the global order, but a simple temporary reorganization of the world, maybe potentially the problem is not that deep. Problems, our problems are not that deep. And Brazil, together with Latin America, could be a part of this conversation, and hoping to that we are interested in doing that.
So the current moment requires courage, creativity, and daring. So hence my great satisfaction of being here and sharing these ideas with you. I'm very happy to be here. I am convinced that this kind of debate, the debate proposed here by the foundations, by the organizations that propose this, very important to foment new viewpoints and bring in new actors. Ioli expressed very well what the group does, the GRRY does, GRRI does, to be able to respond to the challenges put, to have a more active diplomacy in future, and hence my happiness to be here, my joy at being here. Hopefully we'll have new publications, new projects, so I encourage a publication of this very event here. So thank you very much, and let's have a good debate afterwards. Thank you. Thank you, Rafael. Thank you for your great talk. And you stayed within the 20 minutes thanks to my speed, he says. Okay. So there was a speed limit, and still you managed to stay within the 20 minutes. So we have here now our third speaker has arrived, Professor Marco Aurelio Garcia. Well-deserved applause. So now our second speaker, our friend, our comrade, Sebastião Velasco, professor of the Campinas University. Good morning. I'd like to start thanking the initiative, thanking Catarina and Gonçalo for the initiative. The idea of restarting the GRRY's activities with a seminar of this breadth, of this nature. I'd like to say also that it's a pleasure for me to be here, sitting here in this panel among the colleagues that I am among, and to say that there's a major distinction for me in my capacity as member of the GRRI and coordinator of the Institute of U.S. Studies, to be coordinating this network of researchers about the U.S. and as a co-organizer of this event, of this seminar. So I feel distinguished by this. Many of you don't know, I imagine, we had an initial stage of our institute was created in 2008, and for 2 years, 2008, 2009, 2010, a period of crisis in Brazil, there was much uncertainty regarding the continuity or not of the program. There was an RFP in 2014. We presented a proposal, but we didn't know what was going to happen with the program. It was finally approved at the end of last year, was implemented miraculously this year. So we are taking up again the GRRI, and at the same time, a new level, different conditions and adverse conditions of our institute, which aims to create, overall aim, of course, to foment, to encourage, to stimulate the work as the yeast in the dough, to feed into a process, which is a long-running process, to constitute in Brazil a field, a scientific field of studies about the U.S. So to invert in the field of knowledge the asymmetrical relations that had existed between these two systems, between these two poles, one which knows, monitors, everything that happens in the world, and we here who believe we know a little bit about the United States because we sing happy birthday to you, because we listen to rock and roll music, etc. We think we know, we're familiar with facts of everyday life in the US and US history, sometimes more than our own history and our own reality. But in fact, we know very little about the United States, because what we have here is the reproduction of images that come from the North. So that's the challenge of our institute, to reverse, to invert this logic, to have a different viewpoint of the United States and seek responses for the questions that are our own and not the questions that come pre-formulated and pre-answered from the North. So it's a great pleasure for me. So I'm going to begin not by talking in my name, but asking to draw your attention to a brief text that I will read. It begins like this. The Russian expectations about the Trump presidency vary from excessive optimism to excessive fear caused by his unforeseeable nature. Optimism has no grounding because Trump simply will not be authorized to implement his foreign policy initiatives unless he yields on them right before the election or right after being elected. The attempts to implement them will be obstructed by Congress, the bureaucracy, the government bureaucracy, and the establishment in general. Trump or any other person in his place will be forced to carry out a trade-off. The fact that Mike Pence, running mate, accepts the hard line against Russia, which is broadly accepted in the Republican Party, is not a surprise. This is quite an old text. It talks about the Trump's election as a possibility. So this was written. This is a paragraph of an article called "The Elections in the United States and the Cold War 2.0: Implications and Prospects for Russia." That was written by an expert, a Russian expert called Dmitry Suzulov, presented this text in an international organization called the Discussion Club, September 2016. I think it's interesting to start my intervention with this, my remarks with this prognosis, because it allows me to say in more at ease what I have to say about the questions that are the guiding questions of our debate. What is the impact of the Trump era on international relations, especially with regards to Latin America and Brazil? So I'll make a modest and sincere confession of powerlessness, of ignorance. I don't know is the answer. Because to advance in the reflection about the question put, we have to ask ourselves about the Trump era. What do we expect? What might it be? This gentleman was elected at the end of last year, took over government in January 20th this year, so 2 months ago and a few days. So since then, we have witnessed things that had never before been seen in the US, globally, in fact, but particularly for the United States, is our relevance here, relevant for us here. The first was the inaugural speech, which stupefied the world, because unlike the expectations, general expectations, unlike what had happened in other occasions in the past, what usually happens in general, in many countries. So Trump was elected with a nationalist platform, everything we know. Did not moderate his discourse, as would have been expected, in the two moments when this could have happened. The moment when he won, the internal dispute, quite a difficult primary election in the Republican Party, started off with 17 candidates, and he won, gradually knocks down his opponents, bulldozes over all the more traditional politicians within the Republican Party. He's an outsider who imposes himself on the party by converting him, by becoming an expression of this party, which he had joined only very recently, and only then for pragmatic reasons. He did not do what Obama did when he won the primary of the Democratic Party, when he became the candidate back in his time, and he yielded on many of his proposals, or what he was saying he would do for the people, especially for the youth. Then he became closer to the establishment of the Democratic Party, joined his team with Hillary's team, and then appointed Hillary after he took office as his Secretary of State. Trump did exactly the opposite. He treated the chieftains of the Republican Party with kicks and punches. And that's how he won. Did not reach any compromise with the Republican leadership. And when he was elected, did the same. He confronted directly the security services, at the heart of the regime, of course, so went into attrition with the press, with the FBI, with the CIA, so the liberal internationalist press. He had tensions and contradictions, but these were heightened. And when he took over office, made a speech that stupefied, called consternation across the world because of the brutality with which he treated his predecessors, and took up again all the key words of his campaign. This is an initial element of something that was new and an innovation. The next day on television, something new as well. The demonstrations that had already begun, but this time, don't scare me. I have more than 5 minutes, right? Okay. The demonstrations that were very well attended, huge crowds in Washington, New York, California. And right off the bat, the clear expression of a willingness to fight against this president. With this president, we cannot work with. At the start of February, it wasn't even a month into his term, then a scandal that led to the dismissal of an important staffer of the government, which is the National Security Advisor, Michael Flynn, General Michael Flynn, who had already coordinated the intelligence services and who was surprised with a leak regarding conversations that he had with the Russian ambassador that he had not reported to Mike Pence, the vice president. So, this government was shaken from the very beginning by a double pressure from the streets, from the people, mobilized by the Democratic Party, but not only, on the one hand, and sectors of in the press from the very beginning opposed him, but also sectors of the apparatus of the state. So there was a crisis that initiated with this leak and the dismissal of General Flynn. And the crisis isn't over. There are commissions being set up in Congress to investigate the connections, potential connections, between Trump's team and even Trump himself. From the first moment when Flynn fell, the idea that he didn't act on his own accord, talking to the Russian ambassador, but that there was a participation of Trump. This possibility was put on the table, and this is a question that is being investigated in the Senate with the following detail. Jeff Sessions, the Attorney General, who was a former senator, had to step away from this procedure because he was involved himself in these allegations. So on the one hand, you have denouncements of connections, contacts with a foreign power, a country that the US has difficult relations at present with a lot of friction. On the other hand, the denouncement by the Republicans or many Republicans and Trump himself that institutions, American institutions, are being subverted by agencies that work in the underground, disseminating leaks, selective leaks, illegal leaks against Americans. Because the authority of the Secret Services would be to detect this kind of movement by foreigners, by foreign nationals, but to disseminate, to publicize leaks of conversations that happened between American citizens, that would be technically protected. So we are faced with a singular situation never before seen. Maybe I'm wrong, but we have an Institute of US Studies, but we are students. We're not experts of the ins and outs and details of US historical political history. But unless I'm much mistaken, I don't remember any administration that began under similar circumstances, which in a, having to face from the word go, explicitly open threat of impeachment. There is a movement with signatures being gathered for the impeachment of the president, which leaves Mike Pence, the vice president, on the line of succession, which would materialize Suslov's prophecy, which I mentioned in the beginning. So I don't have much time. I have 5 minutes. So I'll briefly refer to also the curious things that are happening here in Brazil. On the day that Trump made his speech, I don't watch TV, I watch the global news channel. I don't normally do this, but sometimes I like to see sometimes what the other side are saying. And I was taken aback because I had the feeling that global had taken a step behind in time and was fighting for the impeachment, not impeachment of President Dilma, but of President Trump, who had recently taken office. So the next day, I read an article by this commentator, Demetrio Magnoli, that reduced Trump to dust, a right-wing political commentator who has as a commentator in this global news channel. So we underwent here in Brazil a coup, and those that were in the front lines of the coup were prone, are prone to, would be prone to embracing this major news, which is the Trump, that the government fell. So I'm, once again, I'm ignorant, so the most adequate, most interesting attitude is doubt, methodical doubt. Expectations, cognitive expectations were contradicted. And we have to think, we have to collect, gather information, and reflect. So I was going to mention in my argument that I had sketched out something that has already been said. So this is a government that is a government under dispute, to use a current term used by us. So there's a more nationalist wing of the Trump government, which is the Steve Bannon faction, let's say. But there's a major sector at the helm that has nothing to do with this, that comes from Goldman Sachs, who are moderate Republicans, globalists, internationalist liberals. Better to qualify them as imperial liberals rather than internationalists. And they are there in the Trump government doing their best to contain and correct the excesses of language, the improprieties of the more nationalist far-right faction. And this is on every plane, inside the government, inside the party, in Congress. The fiasco of the attempt to repeal Obamacare was not produced by the Democrats. Of course, the Democrats were there. There's not such a huge Republican majority, but it was torpedoed by a Republican group funded by one of the biggest financiers of the right wing globally, which is the Koch brothers, who offered millions for the for Obamacare not to be repealed. So I'll conclude with this, the impact, the global impact. What happens all over the world, in Europe, in China, in Japan, in Russia, is that the politicians, not the everyday politicians, but the statesmen, let's say, they think strategically. And those that think strategically think of scenarios, preferable positive settings, or more likely or least likely, or more negative. The golden rule, the basic golden rule of strategic planning, is that you have to be ready for the worst scenario. Because if you're prepared for the worst scenario, you can deal more easily with the others, of course. So the problem with Latin America, I think, the question that is raised for Latin America very, very different. Latin America is a bit of an abstraction. We have very different national situations. So I won't talk about Latin America as a whole, but for Brazil. For Brazil, the problem is that we are undergoing a crisis that is much deeper than the American one, which is not to be disdained. But when I said I don't know what the era Trump will be, I should have added, I don't know how long the Trump era will last. Here in Brazil, we are witnessing, we are living from one day to the next, so to speak, hand-to-mouth existence. We are like a boat lost at sea. And my reading is that the question, the main question is not what to do, what is to be done in relation to X or Y hypothesis of what the US government may do or not do, but rather to make a contribution to put an end to this inadmissible situation we are experiencing in Brazil, an illegitimate usurper government, sold out, a government that is sold out, that cannot sustain itself, that has been in power for too long already. We have to prepare the future in Brazil and reconstruct the conditions to think and plan strategically and take the measures and develop the policies that are a consequence of this. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Sebastian. As you're seeing, with the quality of the comments, I will be elected the most unpopular person in the room because I have to limit the time that they have to speak. But this is all on in behalf of the time that we'll have left for Q&A, for our debate. But I remember, speaking of debate, that we are going to have, if I'm not mistaken, that we are going to have the possibility to have written questions as well. I think that we will receive a form to write your questions. So we have opportunity to ask questions on the mic and also to send questions in written and also questions from the internet. And I'd like to remind you that we are broadcasting this seminar through FTA TV channel. Now we are going to listen to another interesting speech, and I pass the floor to Mr. Marco Aurelio Garcia. Well, I'd like to wish you all a wonderful day. First of all, I'd like to apologize because I was a little late. Especially, I like to apologize with Rafael. But fortunately, I was able to listen to most of his speech. I was impressed with the quality of his speech, and I discovered that he is from Rio Grande do Sul, which explains it all. I like also to say that it's a reason of joy to be able to share this panel with my old-time friend Sebastian and Ioli, and also I like to also acknowledge Friedrich Ebert Foundation as Stiftung Foundation, as they say here in Brazil. I'd like to start by telling you about something that happened to me in Mexico around 40 days, that was 40 days before the elections, the American elections. And I took part of a seminar on United States-Latin American relationship, but more specifically, United States-Mexico relationship. Mexico shelters highly qualified think tank dedicated to study the US. That's why when Chung launched the United States Studies Initiative, I was really happy because I thought that unfortunately in Brazil we did not have an effort as we do have in the Mexico, not only because of its reach, but also because of the quality of the studies. In this seminar that I took part in Mexico, nobody, because of the epistemological power that it's a new category to be introduced, would bet on the election of Trump. And what people were saying, especially in a panel dedicated to the study of conservative intellectuals in the United States, was to calculate the impact of Trump's defeat on the Republican Party. And I'd like to remind you that in the Republican Party, there was a group of conservative intellectuals that is highly qualified and that supported Reagan as in his administration. And after all, a second group arise that seem more like a band of intellectuals that assisted Bush in his administration. And now we were restless to know what would be the generation of intellectuals that would then take care of the Republicans after the expected Trump's defeat. And I share the astonishment of everyone, as was so well described by Sebastian, on what's going to happen in the US after what all was said and done. So we are, all of us who are trying to speak about the global situation, we are all taken by uncertainty and astonishment. We don't know how it all happened, and hardly will we be able to predict what's going to happen. This is serious because unforeseeability is not a quality of those who should speak about the future. We are the ones that should see the signs that will allow us to foresee the course of history. I think that anyway, to talk about these issues, as was done so brilliantly and by the previous speakers, at some. And I'm happy that the GFII is being reconstituted. I think that it's highly interesting for us to study the Trump phenomenon. This is not an isolated phenomenon. This is something that has a broader dimension. And because of the fact that it happened first in the United States, or not exactly first, but it happened in the United States, the greatest global power in current times, it's highly relevant for us. Those who are currently dedicated in organizing events, we should think of the Trump phenomenon as not only as a political event, but as we are doing here, but something that will also influence the whole global scenario today in different areas. Here, we are here to analyze the Trump's relationship between the Brazilian foreign affairs policy and the United States. So I think that it's my suggestion is that we should try to relate internal and external policies of both countries. In the Brazilian case, I think that in the last decade, and maybe for longer, in the last 15 years, there was a greater incidence of interrelation between internal and external, our internal and external policies. And why is that? Because I think that the Brazilian leaders and sometimes even the opposition understood that if it was not only a matter of the country's projection around the world, but also an element, an important element to establish the country's national project. So foreign affairs policy is part of the national development project. And of course, when the government does not have a national development project, as is the case of our current administration, of course, there is an action that erodes our foreign policy and gives it very particular and limited dimension. And I will be back to this in a moment. In the American case, the analysts of the American policy have been observing that not always is there a clear connection between internal and external policies from the point of view of society. From the establishment point of view, of course, but from society's point of view, this doesn't exist. And now I am talking about Perry Anderson's reflections on the topic when he says that somehow the American electors that are characterized by a limited point of view are not much concerned with these issues, maybe because they have a clear perception that Democrats and Republicans, except for small details, did not differ in their foreign policy. Maybe this is about to change with Trump taking office. And it's part of the uncertainties that I referred to previously. So somehow there is an element of the American foreign policy that is not clearly established so far, that suffers from the contradictions described by Sebastian, and that we can identify at this point. We don't know if it's going to be developed at this point, but there is a criticism to the multilateralism, and this is more clearly present in some of the initiatives started by the government, by Trump's government. The withdrawal from the TPP, the decision not to sign a similar treaty with Europe, these are essential elements. And related to all of that, the position of the American delegate in the G20 to remove every mention to the free trade from their final document. So if someone was sleeping for 20 days and just woke up right now, would then be surprised by this extraordinary reality. The president of the United States is nationalist, and China is defending free trade. Who could tell? And we have, of course, a clear element that is part of this anti-multilateralism trend that are the decisions taken in the environmental arena. And in all of these elements, there is a very strong participation of the internal policies, the protectionism philosophy that is somehow leading liberal decisions against the free trade and against environmental protections to protect the sectors that where this was most needed. And with another complexity, in some cases, they are trying to also to create a social basis to support these initiatives, to create a social support to these initiatives. In terms of the Latin America and Brazil in general, I agree with the previous speakers, and I'm under the impression that we will have a reduced participation of Latin America in Trump's concerns from the Department of State and from the administration as a whole. I mentioned the Secretary of State because the Department of State, because those that were worried that maybe Brazil will assume a bilateral position, a divided, fragmented position in Brazilian foreign policy. We see now that in our relationship with different American departments, we have at least 10 people thinking in different positions. Now, those I don't know if you know who I'm referring to, but those who have who are conservative thinkers will continue to do so. So if the current conditions are kept, I think that basically, because Latin America and Brazil specifically, due to the changes that we have been seeing in the country and that are about to be exposed to the international community, we are no longer a geopolitical threat, which we were during the period that were the first 15 years of the 21st century, when we saw a new geopolitical order in the region after the election of different progressist presidents with projects that were different among them in different countries, but which were characterized by common elements. The common elements against them was to make sure that to have a regional sovereignty. This decision to promote our regional sovereignty was translated into different important elements. We created the UNASUR. The UNASUR that would go beyond the free trade matrix that characterized Mercosur since its creation, from which we wanted to get rid. We wanted to go, I'm sorry for the interruption. I don't know how to deal with my cell phone because I thought it was in silent mode, and it's not. I'm sorry. I'm going to turn it off. Please turn it off for me. So, we created a UNASUR, and it's important to say that within UNASUR, we created something that is even more relevant, which is the South American Council of Defense, the Defense Council, that represented a concrete alternative to the regional defense treaties that had been signed since 1948 in the Cold War environment. As UNASUR was broadly accepted, it was not hard to evolve it to CELAC that came as an alternative to another organization created during the Cold War, the Organization of Latin American States, but more than that, Brazil specifically started to have a greater international position, more independent, as we saw during the Tehran Agreement episode, when Turkey and the Iran government established an agreement with Brazil, which was then defeated because of the American claim in the Council or in the G20. And all of that would lead to the creation of a change of forces in the geopolitical sphere. But I want to say that all of these initiatives happen without any attitude from the Brazilian government, and also from attitudes from all from other Latin American governments of an anti-US attitude. Much the contrary, the relationship gap kept between the Brazilian government since last year were very fluid. Not that we did not have situations where we were confronted by serious problems, as it happened in the case of the wires, telephone, the telephone wires, the taps, as that today, that after became object of different measures, and it also ended up in the Petrobras case that we saw afterwards. But with the changes that we saw in Latin America, that some qualified as the end of a cycle, which is another debate that we have to have, if it is effectively the end of a cycle, and my opinion is not very clear about that. I have some hypothesis about that. But given that, Latin America and Brazil specifically do not offer, do not mean a challenge to the United States. They're not a reason of concern to the United States. But I think that effectively the good relationship that we had between Brazil and the US will not continue, because balanced relationships are usually more solid. Unbalanced relationships usually are not solid. In countless times, for example, in the case of Venezuela, we had a very intense participation, and also a participation that was somehow communicated to the American government. And I like to mention a piece of data that is no longer relevant, but and it's not relevant to hide this, but when we created a group of friends of Venezuela that had an important role in the stabilization of Chavez as president, at a certain point, American Secretary of State Colin Powell came to the Brazilian Minister of Foreign Affairs, the Ambassador Celso Amorim, and told him, Celso, I'm sending you the speech that our diplomat will give in the American Congress in Venezuela. I want to know if you agree with it. You only do that when you have balanced, a balanced relationship of common respect, of mutual respect, and instead of a relationship of
servitude.
Of servitude, that's what we seem to be pursuing now. Recently, I saw that the Secretary of State of the United States, a new one, would have asked Serra, or if the new Minister of Foreign Affairs of Brazil, that if we could help in the case of Venezuela. This is impossible. And why is that? Because both were characterized by an ideological position in the case of Venezuela, and didn't know how to create a dialogue that would involve the government and the opposition, and therefore lost their ability to interfere. The alternatives that are open to us right now, and I'm skipping a page because I just received a 5-minute sign, and I want to conclude. So, and I agree with what Rafael just said. We had the option to an easier option to create a relationship with China, which would be more complex than the situation that we had before, and we should be more proactive in this Chinese case, so that we can benefit more from this relationship. And on the second place, even in the BRICS, where we used to have a more intense participation, we are so omissive now that people are calling it now RICS instead of BRICS. In the European Union, I must say that in the last 4 years, since Lula's administration, to be sincere, but more intensively during Dilma Rousseff's administration, we made our best efforts to develop a trade agreement with the European Union. And we were able, during Kirchner's administration in Argentina, to reach an agreement on the offer made by Mercosur. And this was not easy because, of course, that the Argentinian industry would be much affected by an agreement of this nature. And the person who was responsible for this and the European community was the one who benefited most from this agreement. And it's not easy to discover why, because with the crisis that they are living right now, any agreement that involves international trade is more difficult to decide among 27 countries than it is to decide among the members of Mercosur. And I don't know at this point if Venezuela is part of Mercosur or not. And I'd like to conclude, and I'd like to call the attention, your attention to the point that I think is most important here. A foreign policy that does not consider national interests, and therefore that is not concretely associated to this perception of a national development project, of course, is a policy that will hardly establish concepts and will be also difficult to implement. We are losing our character. Whenever we have this sudden changes in governments, we still carry characteristics of the previous government. Of course, we have the military coup, and they created their own personality. They opened they started applying Santiago Dantas and Afonso Arinos' national foreign policy. And as we were living the dictatorship, it has an alias. So it was called responsible pragmatism. But in essence, it was the independent foreign policy that was applied. And that foreign applying that was independent, not only because of its contents, but because of the characters, was renewed and revived in the period of Lula and Dilma's offices. It was a moment of complexity because when the basic concept with which we were dealing with the international context was globalization and the neoliberal globalization. Let's make it clear. But what was the problem? The problem was that at that moment, we had a critical opinion on the neoliberal globalization. And if we examine the set of decisions taken by the governments from 2003 until last year, the foreign policy was probably more to the left, more left-wing than all the other governments' decisions. So this critical positioning allowed us not only to have important benefits for the country, but also allowed Brazil to play a more relevant role in the international sphere. So the new governments, the new governments, the usurpers, chose the worst of our position upon globalization, the neoliberal globalization. From the moment that they adopt their attitude upon globalization, as soon as they adopt this new positioning of globalization, we start seeing a deglobalization around the world. So of course, that in addition to the problems that they are going to have with the international justice, they also going to have to face the problems as the passengers that took their ticket, that bought their ticket to Titanic after the ship had already wrecked. Thank you, Marco Aurelio.
Thank you very much, Marco Aurelio. I liked very much your talk, except the part about the tyrant, calling me a tyrant, obviously. Okay, now we open up for Q&A. We will do the following. We're going to start with spoken questions. People who want to write in their questions. You should give to Liz at the back your written questions, and Reiko here on the other side. They have the forms. And at some stage, bring me the written questions from the internet. Okay? So I have here. Those that wish to speak, raise their hands. Okay, so let's begin. Good morning. Thank you for this debate, allowing us to have such a good debate about this current conjuncture. So the polarization of settings globally, does it favor the perception of a left-wing program? And what is the left-wing project currently? Because there's a lot of confusion about the meaning of this. When we take office, even if we are left, we become the target, and we actually weaken the left in a way. So does this setting favor the awakening, the political awakening of the American people? We always hoped for something that never happened in the US, and now it's happening with Trump, this awakening, this political awakening of the American population. What can we expect from this? An offensive by this conservative, xenophobic, fascistic bloc? Will it be seeking to disassemble the left globally? Are we at the end of the cycle, or is it a rupture? Is it a disruption of major proportions? So are we finding it difficult to act within the governments that we organize? So should we organize as global left-wing blocs to build this new moment for the world? Can we expect a cyber cold war of manipulation of settings? Are we safe under the Temer government because we are negotiating? Can we maintain this safety considering our oil reserves? I didn't say this before, but we expect questions to not exceed 3 minutes, which Andressa abided by. I ask you to introduce yourself before you ask the question, okay? Jefferson from Rio Grande do Sul. So firstly, I want to greet the foundations, Friedrich Ebert Foundation, Perseu Abramo Foundation, the GRRI, our dear friend Gonçalo and Catarina. So very briefly, I want to ask you, all three, to look at the current stage of globalization. Globalization, as we know it, is constantly changing, but there's a major change with the Trump period. I don't know if I know this, if I agree with this idea of deglobalization, or if it's just a new stage. So please devote a few remarks to what is the current stage of globalization we are beginning to experience under Trump. Vicente Trevas, and no more questions for now. Vicente Trevas from São Paulo. I wanted to ask my dear friend Marco Aurelio Garcia to comment a little more about these future settings regarding the agenda. You mentioned China, and this remark that touched me very deeply, that we need to have a more precise agenda, a more broad-range agenda in relation to what the current government has. So a few remarks from you, Marco Aurelio. Regarding Sebastião, I want to ask you, because you're studying the U.S. with more attention, the anti-Trump opinion in the U.S., are there actors, agendas, institutions that would have a more democratic incidence over foreign policy? 2 years ago, 60 mayors were invited by Pope Francis before he went to the U.S. and before the Paris conference. 10 of these 60 mayors were from the U.S. 7 Brazilians were there, 10 Italians. And there was a convergence of agendas. The governor of California was there, who leads a network that wants to anticipate to 2050 the reduction in global warming. The mayor of Seattle, a range of actors that were signaling a certain convergence of agendas. So, and lastly, for our dear friend Rafael to comment, the movements of the European Union. We can talk about Germany a little bit more, because it was very shocking to us, the scene of the press conference of Trump and Prime Minister Merkel. Thank you, Trevas. Now, Gonçalo. Thank you, all our speakers. And thank you, Yoli, for chairing. I want to ask Rafael, what is the debate like about the within the field of IR about the U.S. shutting itself off from the world and American hegemonic thought? So how these two trends debated? What many of you are saying here is that the U.S. will shut itself off. So the Trump policy is led by a domestic agenda, that there is a withdrawal from the international sphere, an abandonment, as Marco Aurelio said, an abandonment of multilateralism. What does this withdrawal mean? And is this withdrawal discussed in the U.S.? Because in the U.S. is accustomed to its own hegemonic power, where the world is governed unilaterally by it. So On our side of things, this withdrawal, this supposed withdrawal, what kind of opportunities does this open up? So if the US is shutting itself onto itself, withdrawing from the international sphere, the pressure and the power, the American power, American activism in the global arena, what opportunities does this lead to? Okay, I'm going to read out a question that arrived in writing. So then we have a block of five questions, very pertinent. I think with these five we can hand back the floor to our speakers. Then we open up a new round, okay? I'm going to keep the order, and in the last one I will invert. 7 to 10 minutes, please. I didn't read out the question. I'm not a facilitator, I'm a difficultizer. Forgive me. Okay, here we go. Question from Augusto from the University of São Paulo. The election of Trump is the product of a conservative ethos / nationalist ethos of the US population, or is it owed more to national and international setting? To all our panel members. Okay. So these are broad questions. It would require a new seminar. I think the questions are well related to each other, let's say. So challenges and opportunities, that's more or less how I try to structure my remarks in the beginning. The first thing is to remind ourselves that we have this polarization, a strong polarization that we're experiencing in Brazil, but it happens in many other countries, all over Latin America, or several countries in Latin America, certainly in Europe and in the US. The US today has a deeply polarized society, divided society. It was a tight election, a feeling that of growing alienation of the people, the general population, from the political system, cynicism with the political system. That is not new. This is a growing trend, but it became deepened by this election. I was talking to Javier from the Spanish consulate, who is present. The perception of main part of American society is that political parties do not offer a channel of political participation to the citizenry. If there's a crisis of liberal democracy globally, then that crisis is greatly present to a large extent in the US. That's why you have a TV celeb as president, right? So this was the major pivot of Trump. Trump always liked this idea of speak evil but speak of me. The media was extremely cooperative in maintaining this process. The US media hasn't properly reflected upon its own role in Trump's election, and certainly not in the level that would be required, the depth that would be required. And Trump played this very well. Is there a conservative ethos? So American society is very conservative. That is clear. What you call left there is a very conservative party, the Democratic Party. There isn't the possibility of a left-wing party. Mainstream America is very conservative. cultural, religious aspect, but particularly regarding foreign policy. There is a hegemonic bloc, which is centrist to the right, and Trump, as well as being a TV personality, he used very well this idea of deepening militarism, xenophobia, nationalism, the terrorism, immigration, joining the two together, the illegal Mexican as the scapegoat, talking about favoring sectors of society, which clearly they're not going to favor, which is white, poor white people, and suddenly they're very surprised with what Trump was trying to do with Obamacare. So a fractured society, does this help the left at all? I don't know I would use the word to favor. The left has to react because of its own needs. The Democratic Party is in deep crisis. The political system is in deep crisis. We have to remember that not just Trump was an outsider. Bernie Sanders was another candidate that had a major popular appeal. Is not even officially a member of the Democratic Party, also an outsider, and somebody who could potentially mobilize new sectors of society. So this polarization here, globally in the United States, doesn't matter, opens up the possibility, or more challenge than possibility, to rethink how to mobilize in the new context. I don't think this is something that helps the left, but it requires the left to think about how to reorganize. And I do see this happening in the US. Social movements, and even the Democratic Party, reminding itself that we have to go back to the grassroots. We have to reestablish links to the social movements with NGOs, progressive NGOs. So this challenge, this need is unveiled. This is happening. It's one of the few signs for causes for optimism, as well as the fact that the establishment is putting the brakes on Trump, considering the difficulty in approving the major promise, which was the reform of Obamacare. The establishment is putting the brakes. For whatever reason. But despite this, Trump will do major damage. Just yesterday, he canceled all the policies to combat global warming. That in itself is extremely harmful. For Americans in general, members of the political establishment, opinion formers are paying attention that they were naive to think that we have a democracy that is consolidated, presidential power is not that great, we have the checks and balances, etc. This thing of the presidential, super powerful presidents is a Latin American phenomenon. No, over there, if you know how to manage the machinery of the state, you can do a lot of damage just with the presidential executive orders. Since we're here having this dialogue with European institutions, so this we are here discussing to say that we are rethinking through a lot of things. This opens up opportunities for the left outside of the US as well. Once again, I don't want to retread the ground. There's this whole thing about organizing as networks. I think the left, the crisis the left faces in Brazil, Latin America, in the US, in Europe, they're not the same crisis exactly, but a lot of things are in common, and exchanging information, dialogue, organizing as networks, having enhancing our discussions, that's important. I agree with Marco Aurelio in the sense that it's hard to say that we're at the end of the cycle or not. The multilateral institutions that organize the post-war world are in crisis. They've been undermined gradually for a number of years, which allowed countries like Brazil to take a seat at the global discussions. Marco Aurelio was part of the Lula and Dilma governments, understood this context and was agile in responding to this. And so let's take part in that. Participation, capacity to participate in this conversation right now, today, with the current interim government we had is very limited, but it should be happening. This crisis of the multilateral order in the post Second World War, that what will replace it? That's the major question. It's not a given. It's not clear to anyone. Nobody knows. So once again, I agree with Marco Aurelio. Who would believe that the U.S. is against free trade and China is in favor? If we had slept for 30 years and woken up today, we would be very surprised. So there are possibilities that are open. The global power games is heavy. It's not played by equals. But there's possibilities for some discussions, for new links, for new alternatives. But let's be sincere, let's be honest. If the right is feeling strengthened in many countries, they have their own internal debates and crises, their own internal feuds. The US, the UK is leaving the European Union, but they're lost. They don't know how to carry out, how to implement Brexit, if there'll be a turnaround. I don't want to talk about cycles or pendulums, but it's a moment of major challenges. So if we're able to respond to these challenges adequately, there are opportunities, sure. Globalization is entering a third stage, I would say. It's the Clintonian 90s, for good and for evil, which was the summit of this multilateral globalization post-Second World War, was guided by the WTO. Clinton was selling it, but that was the discourse. Join the global economy, take part, and this will solve your problems. And for some countries that were able to do this, there were benefits, as well as there are always benefits and losses at local level. With Bush, and after 2001, the 9/11, we started seeing new aspects of globalization, whether it be terrorism or other questions. So there was a turnaround, more problematic, more perverse aspects of globalization, like increasing inequality, etc. They become clearer. And now a third phase, which is a crisis, but with challenges opening up, the possibility and the need, in fact, of the task, the homework of how to respond is before us. And responses are appearing. There are states, important states in the US, California, but especially cities, social movements that are needing and managing to respond, as well as universities. I come from a university that have already declared sanctuary where we will not turn over undocumented students to the authorities. We will protect our staff, our students. It's a new moment, a new legal. When the police come, what are you actually going to do? We don't know, but universities are saying this. There's a person in Denver where I live, a Mexican activist, who for 2 months has been living in a Methodist church in the city center because she was going to be deported, and the church took her in, and it became a cause célèbre. What is going to happen to her? And she's there, separated from her family, in exile inside the church, but trying to show the situation that there are responses. They are tough, they are difficult, they will require much work, but the major question for us, if we are to respond, is because we've noticed that we have commonalities in different places. So how can you shut the country off and at the same time have a hegemonic role in the world? That was Gonzalo's question. It sounds contradictory, but it isn't. You can do that. That's the Bushite. So a unilateralism with hegemonic pretensions, right? For good and for evil. So Iraq war cost 150,000 lives, but it broke the back of the American economy. It costs trillions of dollars. So even though you have a more protectionist discourse, doesn't mean you can't have hegemonic foreign policy. We don't know how the minister, the Secretary of State, the Secretary of the Treasury share these views. We don't know how this debate will play out within the Trump administration. So once again, challenges, opportunities all around.
Thank you, Rafael. And Sebastian, please. Well, I tried to combine the different questions, not necessarily by chronological order, and I will start by the last one about the nationalism and conservative aspect of the American society. There's no doubt, Augusto, that both elements are present. In the case of conservative, the conservative characteristic, Rafael gave us different elements, but I would add to that that with the exception of the Socialist Party that even ran for presidency with 8 or 9% of votes in the beginning of the 20th century, the left wing in the US, differently than what happens in Europe and Latin America, never became a real political power, never became a real presence in the political partisan system. It doesn't mean that there's no left wing in the US. They have a strong presence in the cultural environment. But the prevalence belongs to the conservatives. Nationalists in the US more than in anywhere else in the world, a consensus. You go to the US and you see national flags all over the places, in the in houses, and there's no doubt about it. So there are some variables that are present here. But along with these variables, the American government along the 20th century showed different natures. It's impossible to describe Franklin Roosevelt as a right-wing government. So I think that the key here to understand what happens today in the US and what happened in the past is not so much related to the characteristics that are shared by the American, but more related to what happens in the economical and political arena. And then I start also with this answer to the second question. There, the financial crisis of 2008 is a very relevant element. The 2008 economic crisis and the intense increase of social inequalities is not something that comes from the skies. These are fruit of determined of certain decisions, and decisions that were taken by the Democratic Party, the Clinton's political party. In the 1980s in the US, we saw a repositioning of different parts of the puzzle, and the Democratic Party that was traditionally a party related to social movements and to unions got further and further away from these actors, got distant from them, embraced the financial market, and changed its agenda. And the importance to the different identities, to an identity-based policy, as we call it, became more and more important in the American platform. I have no doubt, and it's worth noting that the extreme importance given by this platform by Hillary Clinton will have an important effect on the final result of the elections. I watched Hillary's debate with Trump, where the issue was not right to abortion or not, but if abortion was allowed in the 8th month of pregnancy. And she would say this is a right that belongs to women. This is a right to their right to choose. But I have the impression that to defend this position in France, in England, and in Brazil, in anywhere else in the world, would have an important and destructive electoral effect. And it really happened in the US, from my point of view. So there are different elements, and let's not promote a sociological investigation of the American vote. But this is an important element. So important segments of Obama's electors were transferred to Trump. But more importantly, they simply not left their homes to vote. So I'd say that there is a conservative background, of course, but the mentality of a people, of common people, of different groups, of the average population, not intellectuals, there are contradictions that form this mentality. And what prevails here and there will depend on the different interactions that this population is subject to, in depends also on the circumstances in which they are inserted. The answer to Andressa's questions, the awakening of the American population, can this happen? Is this possible? Well, somehow it's already happening. We could see this even from far away, we can see this, and this is something that is being investigated, analyzed, and with an important president, which is the Tea Party. Obama won the election in 2008 in a much more expressive victory than what Trump had now. Trump did not win the popular vote, and this is something else. This is something apart. Obama won by all accounts. He had the Congress. He had an expressive difference over McCain, and when everyone thought that the depression, the lack of orientation will win the Republican Party, we saw the emergence of this bottom-up movement, which was the Tea Party. So this is something that is not unknown to us. This effect is possible and could happen. And then, Vicente, the issue of democracy. Well, there is no doubt that this situation creates opportunities, contradictory opportunities for those who are struggling against this government or a right-wing government. Because if our friends who are left-wing Democrat liberals were in the office, we would be in more adverse conditions than what we have today, because hardly we would be able to exchange with the right-wing government. Now we are at least in a balanced situation. The multilateralism, and then I will say something, Faustino Gonçalo. There is no question that this is a strong movement, that this is not something that starts with Trump. in society, we had this as an ever-present element, and Bernie Sanders, for example, was an example of that. Then we had convergence, and the American politics also included this multilateral or bilateral, even unilateral card, as they pleased. Globalization, from the point of view of the international economic system integration, this is not being questioned, but the institutional configuration of the world economy is certainly seeing relevant changes. Thank you, Sebastião, and I'd like to remind you that we are still receiving written questions. So if you wish to ask more questions, you can please fill in the form that you received for that. Marco Aurélio, you have the floor. I'm not going to answer to the individual questions. I'm going to try to group them out. Because we have common points among the answers. So let's make it clear that the nationalism that is attributed to Trump in comparison to nationalism that we saw in the United States in other moments, these nationalisms are not incompatible with the imperialist nature of the history of the United States in the 20th century. If we go back to this history, we see that, and there were certain times when the American isolated positioning did not mean that they abandoned their preeminent position around the world. This is a problem that is in the roots of the American society. We don't have time to discuss that, but after the revolution that led to the constitution of the government in the United States, it became clear that this new state that was created in a moment before the French Revolution, and it's important to say that, took over the mission to export their values to create a civilization around the world. This is something that we saw during the Arab Spring. Let's export our democracy. This is a problem that is rooted in the basis of the American Constitution. There is a countless number of different quotes and quotations in this sense. And so we will not see the withdrawal of the United States and of this global arena, so much so that Trump increased the military budget by 10%. And of course, that this military budget is already earmarked to make sure that the United States play an important role in the international field. So I insist on that. Let's analyze the history of the United States in the 20th century, and we will see that this is not incompatible with what we're seeing now. The United States kept its imperialistic vocation in a continuous fashion, so much so that President Wilson that intensified this trend of the American democratic model imposing themselves on the rest of the world, and also after that, when the United States was accused to be isolationist. So the second question, the issue of the left ring around the world. This is a problem that is difficult to chew. We must realize that this year we are going to celebrate 100 years of the Russian Revolution. For decades, the world was inspired by this paradigm. Either the paradigm of going against it, the social democrat paradigm or the paradigm of the Russian Revolution. So the division around the Russian Revolution was the fruit of these different visions that somehow inspired the left wing all around the world. And there was not much beyond that. You could have a critical vision, the Trotskyism, for example, against the revolution, or you had a different vision on the social democrat reform. But these paradigms, after the 1970s, maybe even before that, but after the 1970s, lived a crisis. And as we see the fall of the Berlin War, the end of the Soviet Republic, the end of the Central European Republics, the turnaround of China in direction of the capitalism, the impact that we saw in China, Korea, and other countries. And on the other hand, a neoliberal trend of social democracy that was expressed by the Third Way and things of in the same sense. I must say, and this is not only because of our sponsors, that the German social democrat democracy that in the Godsberg Congress addressed the social democrat struggle did not adopt much a leftist profile, probably because of a sociological characteristic, the fact that in Germany we still saw relevant working class that is part of the unionism and it's part of the partisan movement. As I'm not part of the government right now, I can simply speak my mind. When the German social democracy realized that this coexistence with the Christian democracy was not going well, it left this partnership and try to adopt a new profile. All progressists around the world are happy with the idea that Martin Schulz will become the new chancellor. But all of that, anyway, does not make it easier for us because the crisis of the left wing goes on and it's complex because a left-wing crisis, together with the word crisis, is terrible. And there are people who do not agree with that. But the crisis of capitalism, most cases, they produce a counter-revolution and not a revolution. And this is a problem to which we must pay attention. We are living, if this crisis persists, and this is a crisis that started in 2008, but was already being formed before of that. If this crisis persists and it does not find any resistance in left-wing sectors and democratic sectors in general, we could follow a very difficult path. A third world war has already been going on for a while now, but it's fragmented. And of course, it is not global at this moment because those who push the button will be the last act of this war. So I'd say that the problem that the leftists are facing in the United States, not different from that, is a reconfiguration of their paradigms. And to that end, we must understand deeply what's going on in these accelerated changes that capitalism is going through. We are seeing brutal phenomenon. For example, 10 people that control half of the wealth around the world. But we are seeing also other phenomena that allows the left wing today to easily move around the world. What Sebastian mentioned here is true. United States, which is a conservative society, you have at the same time a cultural left wing that it's extremely, extremely active and extremely relevant. And I would say And maybe this could be the object of a different debate here, that this had an important effect on Trump's victory. Trump, in fact, was able to capture part of the American society that was feeling weakened on the economic side, that was being squeezed by some economic policies that were trying to reach equality and that were not did not have any empathy with the government. This is a problem that should concern the left wing in general. It's not wrong for us to defect the gay society and that we defend abortion and a number of different issues, the so-called new themes, the new topics. Then people accuse us not to worry about these new topics, but we are concerned with that. But we should also worry with the old topics, with the old themes. And these are the ones that are somehow materialized in the concept that only old people will use, that it's called a struggle of classes.
The tyrant, once again, harries me. Okay, I want to make clear, I use the expression deglobalization. Okay, I mean that anecdotally, of course. Initiatives, trends that go against globalization. I'm not saying that this is a process of deglobalization. If Marine Le Pen wins the election in France, she won't, but let's say she was to win. If the far right had won in Holland on a whole number of other elections in the pipeline, we could be faced with a situation, a very serious situation, which is the formation of national poles, which is what preceded the two world wars. Let's be clear about that. The two world wars were preceded by situations where nationalism, economic nationalism, radical economic nationalism asserted itself. I just want to draw attention to one last thing. The United States will relate to Brazil on those clichés that we have. No, I don't think so. For everything that was mentioned here in this panel, notwithstanding, this means concretely governmental action, diplomatic action. There is an action from the business sector, not just things that have been little studied. For example, the attacks on Petrobras, the state oil company in Brazil, the attacks on the building companies in Brazil, whose owners should go to prison, some of them, of course, but the companies should remain, right? The attacks now on the protein companies, those responsible for frauds should go to prison. Yes, but they shouldn't disappear. And coincidentally, the attack that is being taken forward is against those companies where we were highly competitive. Many of these companies and others are being bought, being acquired, and the information that the economists give us is that the majority, that many foreign companies are buying foreign companies, buying Brazilian companies, and these Brazilian companies are being shut down. So there won't be much comfort to think that the State Department won't put pressure. No, we will have pressure, silent pressure. And that doesn't mean it's less effective. From the business in the US business sector, and in general, from the business sector globally.
Muito obrigada, Marco Aurélio.
Thank you, Marco Aurélio.
Pelo tempo do que dispomos,
now, I think we can open up for two more spoken questions. And we have one from Twitter. We have a question from Twitter. So the Twitter question is going to be projected on the screen.
Thomas está escrito, mas
okay, Thomas, one more. One going once, going twice. Okay, so we'll have Thomas's question. And in the meantime, our technical people swear that they're going to project the Twitter question on the screen here for everyone to see.
Good morning. Thank you for these tremendously interesting presentations. If people are like me, you're grappling to order all this material and make sense of it. And so I want to make two questions, one about Brazil and then one about the United States. My name's Thomas Pally. I'm from Washington, D.C. The first question, people have noticed that, well, there's a worldwide trend towards nationalist authoritarianism. Putin in Russia, Erdogan in Turkey, Trump in the USA, Temer here. But so we see a common response in all these countries, but is there a common cause? And I particularly, this is directed towards the Latin Americans here, because Mauricio Macri in Argentina, what happened here in Brazil, this doesn't seem to me the same as the United States or Russia or Western Europe. And that then asks me to inquire, why did it happen here? We had Cristina Fernandez in Argentina, Lula and Dilma Rousseff here. What were we doing right and what were we doing wrong? Well, that we must inquire of that, because only then can we begin to put in place the solutions that we need. Now my question about the United States. Coming from the United States, I hear a lot of talk of Trump. And I'm very worried about this personification of the problem. If Trump goes, does Trumpism go away too? I don't think so. Replacing Trump with our Vice President, Mike Pence, could almost be a step backwards. You will have a more intensified neoliberalism, more militarism, more nationalist, the worst features, and he has more credibility in the system than does Trump. So let us avoid today, yes, Trump does bring some peculiarities, and he does move people in ways that we must understand, but let us also be aware that this is he's a man operating in a system, and as I'll talk about this afternoon, there's a lot of bait and switch. He's more in the system than he's letting you know. And that, by the way, is part of the secret of this success.
Thanks, Thomas. E agora, tchan, temos a pergunta.
Now do we have the question from Twitter on the screen? No.
Alguém pode copiar no papel?
Can somebody?
Já está chegando. Enquanto isso, vou dar duas boas notícias.
I'm going to give you two good news.
A primeira.
The first. Are they going to switch off the air conditioning? No, no, that's not the news I'm going to give. So the first good news is that the Perseu Abramo Foundation is making available free of charge, as is our policy, some books. So there's some books outside. When you leave for lunch, you can pick one up. Many of these books One is about the right wing, coordinated by our good friend Sebastião here to my right. All of them have interesting, pertinent topics, including relating to what we're debating today. And the second item of good news is that Friedrich Ebert invites us all for lunch at the restaurant of the hotel during the break. Okay? So there is a free lunch. Now the internet question. From Rogério through Twitter. Are we going to get it on the screen? I was going to spoil the surprise by reading it out. Are you sure? Okay, read it out. The question is, what's the level of dependence of the usurper government of Brazil in relation to the United States? What's the level of dependence of our coup-plotter government in relation to the U.S.? That is Rogério's question from Twitter. Now I will hand the floor back to our speakers, asking them to respond to the questions, but also to wrap up with their final remarks. Okay, regarding the Twitter question, dependence, voluntary servitude is the answer. Second question, I think. It's very, the two questions are very opportune that Thomas has raised. Why was there a coup in Brazil? I think in the next few years, 2-3 years, okay, let's be serious. To summarize, to provide the table of contents, so to speak, of our reflection. I answered the tweet with fewer words than the question. Voluntary servitude. Why did we have the coup? I like to mention a sentence by a conservative politician of the 19th century in France called Odilon Barrot. Odilon Barrot, in 1848, faced with major difficulties that France was experiencing, said, "Legality kills us." This was the problem from the point of view of the coup plotters. That was the reasoning that imposed itself. After 4 presidential elections where they were defeated, they realized that they couldn't continue their political project within the framework of legality. Legality was killing them. However, this answer can be unilateral because it doesn't take into account the responsibilities of those that were the objects of the coup. Those are major responsibilities. They have to be the object of critical judgment, in-depth judgment. The political forces and even Brazilian society are starting to do this. However, we face today some difficulties to conduct this judgment adequately. Firstly, because it's always painful to analyze defeat. It's easier to celebrate and analyze. Very often, and the analysis comes together with the celebration of the victories, because we have to understand our difficulties, some are within our grasp to solve, and the mistakes that the 4 governments that we led. These mistakes were not few in number, which is not to say that we got a lot of things right. We weren't able. So this is the index, okay? The table of context of the problems. This we could have a lot of lengthy debates about this. We weren't able to try to solve some problems that are, I don't know if they are solvable in the short term, and which are. In 2002, a coalition of political forces took office, arrived at the government, not in power, with a wish to change the country and face some of the key questions of the country, chief among which was the issue of inequality. That was and remains the key problem and will continue to be the problem. Inequality understood not just as an economic problem with visible social impacts, but which has to be understood as an ethnic problem, a gender problem, a urban-rural problem, a cultural problem, an educational problem, etc. We gradually tackled these with some successes in some spheres and less success in others. But I think we can display convincing results. This is a strategy of reforms. And reforms bring about the wish for further reform. Reformism is not something that at certain point stops. Reformism, like democracy, is a process that is endless, that is constantly bringing about new dimensions and, in my judgment, at certain point has a deeply destabilizing character of the dominant order. So, see, in the 60s, those of us who are old enough, we believed that revolution would solve the problems. Then we realized, because of what happened with many revolutions, that this wasn't on the agenda. So we went through periods of enormous difficulty all over Latin America, nearly all of it, and little by little, so initially around political democracy, and the second moment, social and economic democracy, we built an agenda that sought to provide responses to the new problems that were being put. We did not come to terms with revolution fully. The revolution stayed in our posters, in our t-shirts. We did not deny it, and neither did we did think through it. Equally, we haven't been able to approach more in depth, more intensely, the questions arising from the reformist processes that we execute, that we carried out, and the resistance that these would face. This is the key question, in my judgment, that is put on the agenda today, whether for the Congress of the Workers' Party or next year's presidential election, whether for our daily lives or for the struggle in universities, in unions, doesn't matter where. We have to have clarity about the following. Any initiative we have to try to transform what the Italians called strong reformism, any of them will always bring about problems, difficulties, and therefore we're not talking about a peaceful path. This is one of the problems we face. We weren't able to measure all the consequences of the initiatives that we were taking. thinking this through will help us seize the initiative once again. I don't think we are experiencing a period of in-depth counter-revolution, so to speak. Some people talk about you know about we are living in a state of siege, in a state of war. No, you've not seen one if you're saying that. We maybe have a couple of light paint brushes. Of authoritarianism, but nothing like a state of exception, as we say in Latin America. So Trump is a character, of course. He is not an anodyne figure, as we have in the presidency of other countries. Other countries over there is a true clown, a real clown with all the characteristics, but an enormously efficient one. And let's be clear, the initiatives that were taken, the makeup of the cabinet, even the vice president is always a problem. We have to pay close attention that maybe the worst hasn't yet happened. The worst may be yet to come. People are calling Pence Pencer.
Thank you, Marco Aurelio. So now I pass the floor to Sebastião for 5 minutes. For your final remarks. I will start where Marcos ended. The very appropriate observation about the inconvenience and the traps of thinking politics under proper names and thinking subjectively about Trump. There is no doubt that this is an important person, and I don't know how if we would have personalities in Brazil or even the US to play the role that he did play. But Trump is the expression of a political crisis, of a polarization that was being cooked for a long time in the U.S., a fragmentation of the political parties, and the existence of sectors that do identify themselves as Republicans, but that were very favorable to someone as Trump is, that would come from outside, that would point out to a path that was different than what was proposed by Jed Polls, that Ted Cruz, the Republican governments, people that played key roles in the party, but that were systematically defeated. It was not Trump who defeated them. There was an uncomfortable feeling, on the other hand, in the Democratic field that also brought the name of a senator that was not even a part of the Democratic Party, Bernie Sanders. So if we wish to understand Trump, we should also try to understand the broader movement that the American society showed recently. I'm not going to go deeper in the question of Brazil after having heard Marco Aurelio. I'm not going to give you all of my impressions, but after Marco Aurelio gave us the results of his reflections, that he is a very qualified observer and also playing a key role on our history, I'm not going to go to comment on his observations because This is not necessary, but a part of the question calls my attention on another aspect. This not necessarily has to do with our issues of our internal politics. This does not happen only in Brazil. It's happening in Argentina. We are seeing a movement that goes beyond our country or any other country. So some of you maybe were 3 years ago, you were present when we launched a book, when in our conference on foreign politics that was between the first and the second rounds of the Brazilian election in 2014. It was a moment of great enthusiasm. In the following week, we would have the final round of the elections. And I said, I was reflecting on how to understand the brutal polarization that we were already seeing on those elections that serve as the foundations of what came after the embargo of the result of the elections on the part of the right wing. So they had the experience of four times being defeated, but there was another point that I simply touched on that occasion. In the world of 2014 was much different from the world of 2002 or 2006. The situation was very complex, where the geopolitical balance, economic balance, yes, but especially geopolitical balance was being questioned. And Brazil is not a minor country, is not an important player in this architecture. So this is the reality. And today, I tell you, Thomas, what I'm going to repeat today what I said at that moment. Brazil was the stage of a political dispute that went beyond, and still a political dispute that goes beyond the our national borders. I could go on, I could go into greater detail about this topic, but in this issue of the fight against corruption, which is a permanent part of our agenda, of the agenda of our societies, it's not something that is recent in our history. It's something that has been with us as a disease. And the political crises, the ones that are provoked, or the political crises that adopt the theme of corruption as a catalyst. And I'd like to remind you of 1954 with Getúlio in the office. This crisis, they are not justified by corruption. The crisis brings corruption as a catalyst and brings it, raises it to this dimension with this characteristic, trying to give it a political character. And we are living now the situation in which the mechanisms that fight corruption and the theme of corruption is not a merely national topic. It's something that became globalized and in this global environment is being manipulated as in a broader sense than it was in the past. Thank you, Sebastian. So in order not to be elected as a tyrant, I have good news to give you. We have the information that now, in this morning debate, we had more than 14,000 views, which is a relevant number of views, an important audience. And now for your final remarks, I pass the floor to Rafael. I will start by the relationship between Timor and the U.S. in addition to the servitude. It's an obsolete and incompetent servitude. It's an attempt to renew the neoliberal agenda when the doors are all closing down to it. Even China, ironically and tragically, has been defending multilateral approaches, and this is always also being is being also internally adjourned there. So obsolete and incompetent. There's non personification of the problem in with Trump is correct. This is a correct approach. Trump would probably be the only character that could have won this election. So let's not minimize the personality, but he's a channel that was used by Republicans to reach the power, to make it to the power. Maybe there was no other channel available last year, but with or without him, the agenda is there, and the characters and the Congress, Mike Pence as a governor articulating the relationship with the Congress is there. The agenda is there with or without him. So I am less, I believe less in the impeachment than I believe 2 or 3 weeks, but this is changing on a daily basis. So it's still possible that the scandal of the Russian influence to become unbearable, and that we see this pro-impeachment movement. But I don't think this will come so soon. And it's important to differentiate that, that even if Trump is overthrown, this does not eliminate his agenda, the agenda proposed by him. And this goes back to a more interesting issue. If we have common points in the resurgence of the right wing, of authoritarianism, of the global xenophobia, I think there's a common point here, which is globalization from the point of view of the excluded, the discontent people. Globalization has already showing more and more its the fact that it's not a homogeneous, it accelerates trends, and the trends that are accelerated are the ones that aim to integration and also that aim at exclusion. So there is a feeling of generalized discontent around the world in societies, in different societies. And that supports an agenda that is more conservative, that belongs more to the right. And then governments will show specific characteristics. How you will address xenophobia in Russia is different than what you will do in the United Kingdom, in France, in Turkey. You will play the cards that you have. So this is the global aspects, and that there are also local aspects. In Latin America, coming back to what concerns us more in Brazil, there's a demobilization that happened also in the United States of the grassroots movement, the deeply rooted movements that got lost. You lost this direct contact with the population's response that could be mobilized in the United States and can be mobilized in the United States and in Brazil also against this neoliberal agenda. So the question of what went wrong comes together with the question of what went right. Most of what we said in Latin America in 2 or 3 years responds, as Macarejo said, to what went right. If there was a loss of this mobilization in the grassroots movements, also there was the deepening of the struggle of classes in the sense that the left wing also got it right and got more terrain. So we must learn with that. Maybe the disconnection with this grassroots movements and the Democratic Party is trying to learn with that. And this is the same challenge that we face here in Brazil and Latin America. And these are my brief comments about this. And finally, and this is my final participation, I'd like to thank again for the invitation to be here. Marco Aurelio reminded us that I come from Rio Grande do Sul, but I am available to keep up with this conversation and other common projects. Thank you. I wish to thank all the organizers on behalf of the GRRI. I'd like to thank Rafael Iori's comments, Sebastião Velasco from Unicamp, Marco Aurélio Garcia from Unicamp, former special assistant for Lula and Dilma administrations. I'd like to thank everyone that is following us on this plenary session and also over the internet. And I'd like to invite you to continue with us in the afternoon. We are going to have two interesting panels still in the same subject. The first panel on regional and international integration in the trade agreements, and the second on migrations and labor. As it's 12:43, I think we will come back a little bit earlier, and we will resume with the next panel on 1:45 or 1:45. Okay? So I wish you all an excellent lunch. And remember Milton Friedman, that's no free lunch. Okay?